sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand, you never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. Stumbled in the wind, you heard my cry to you and raised me up again. But my strength is almost gone, how can I carry on if I can't find you? But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm mercy falls. I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand.
Yeah. thought you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again I say amen, and it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you.
My mic's a little bit hot here. I'm going to not teach or preach. I'm going to show a video. And this video is going to be an interview between David Norris and David Benard. These two men, David Norris is the one who wrote the book Life, Death, and the End of the World that I've been teaching out of, mostly. And Brother Benard is the general superintendent over in the world over the United Pentecostal Church International. They're going to be talking about the end time. And so they have some really great revelatory stuff on this. It kind of coincides with what I've been teaching about the end time. Now, I will tell you this. I follow these guys. These guys are my rock, my anchor, other than Jesus, of course. But, you know, if you took all of us and combined all of the ministry that we've done in our lifetime, these men individually have done more in 10 years than we have in our lifetime. That's how much they have accomplished for the kingdom of God. So without any further, let me just say one last thing is if they say something that I've said differently, they're right, I'm wrong. Because they know their stuff and I trust them. Amen? Amen. Brother John, say a word of prayer for our offering.
Lord, we are humble tonight to be privileged to yes, Jesus. Have something to give.
Amen. All right. As he goes around, if you haven't checked in, check into Facebook. And we need your pictures, and I'm still really hot up here. If you guys, ladies, could help me out here. Please, we need them by tomorrow. We accept digital and physical copies. If you have any mom you wish to honor, bring those pics and give them to my wife. Men's breakfast is Saturday, May 7th, 10 a.m. at the McDonald's on Ashland Road. That's where 30 and 42 intersect. And then ladies' breakfast is going to be the second Saturday each month at 10 a.m. This one is going to be Bob Evans on 4th Street, and that's going to be May 14th. One last announcement tonight is Family Night, Saturday, May 21st at 4 p.m. More details to follow regarding that. And at this time, we're going to quickly go do our prayer. We're going to put the list of prayer names up on the board. We do want to pray for Sister Twyla is not feeling good. Sister Bonnie is not feeling good. Continue to remember Sister Bond's Sister Dolores Reynolds, who is back in the hospital, as well as Aaron Rose, who's being deployed close to Ukraine, I believe in Romania, so we want to pray for him as well. Let's stand tonight as we go before the Lord in prayer, lifting our hands and lifting our faith tonight. Lord Jesus, as we come before you tonight, Lord, we love you from the very depths of our heart. And we put our complete faith and trust in you tonight, Jesus. Lord, we know that you are the God that heals. Not only that can you heal, but you want to heal. You want to meet the needs, oh God, that we have. And I pray right now for all of these that are on the board and all the needs that we've called out. By the authority of your word and the power of your name, we speak healing right now in Jesus' name into their lives. Rebuking the spirit of infirmity and commanding it to leave their bodies. Lord Jesus, you are bigger than cancer. You're bigger than heart disease. You're bigger than stroke. You're bigger than all ailments that come against us, oh Lord. And Jesus, we put our trust in you tonight that you're going to bring victory not only to our bodies, but you're going to bring victory, oh God, to our hearts and our minds and to our family, Lord Jesus. You're going to bring victory to this church in Jesus' name. Lord, there's going to be healing and miracles, oh Lord. There's going to be deliverances, oh God. And we pray that right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray for the children of Israel tonight. I plead your blood over them. Lord, that you would protect them, O God, from the enemy that wants to destroy them, O Lord. Protect their borders. Protect them around the world, O Lord. Let them, O God, find peace, O Lord, in you, Jesus. Let them realize that you are their Christ, their Messiah, their King that they're looking for. And let there be a revival that comes back to Jerusalem like it was in Acts chapter 2 at the birth of the church. And everyone say, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. Let's give a hand clap of praise unto the Lord tonight. Amen. Sister Stephanie, if you would go ahead and just let's, you may be seated. We're going to go ahead and start that video.
Welcome to the world headquarters of the Oneida Pentecostal Church International. We're glad you've joined us today for a discussion on the topic of Bible prophecy. My name's Jonathan Moore. I'm the Director of Communications for the Oneida Pentecostal Church International. And with us today, we have two very special guests who, for many of you, you will not need an introduction to them. We have with us our General Superintendent, Dr. David K. Bernard, and we have Urshan Graduate School of Theology Professor, Dr. David Norris. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
And just a little background on both of these gentlemen. Of course, you know that Dr. Bernard has written a number of books, and in those books, he's touched on the subject of Bible prophecy. And Dr. David Norris has written a book called Life, Death, and the End of the World, which is required reading if you want to become a credentialed minister with the United Pentecostal Church International. You can pick up a copy of that book at the Pentecostal Publishing House website, PentecostalPublishing.com. Gentlemen, we're glad to have you here today. Dr. Norris, you wrote an entire book on Bible prophecy. I'd like you to start by telling us, what is Bible prophecy and why is it important?
You know, the Bible is one big story. It's God telling his redemptive plan. In the beginning, God created, and it was good. And then, of course, humans sort of muffed that up. But God had a plan. And at the very center of it is Jesus Christ. And so because God is God, not only can he go back to the very beginning, but he can tell the future as well. It's no harder for God to say, in the beginning, thus and so happened. I spoke these words and so on, than it is for him to say the end of the story, kind of the happily ever after in a book, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. So prophecy is simply that telling of the future of the story that God has planned all along.
Some people would say that, you know, we should focus on Acts 2:38 and sort of let all that other stuff figure itself out. But obviously that's not your take. You've wrote an entire book on the topic. What would you say, what's your response to that sort of line of reasoning?
Sometimes people think that prophecy is all that mysterious, secret visionary stuff when you have a lion with wings and a crazy beast that no one can seem to identify. But most prophecy is very straightforward. And even when you have those kinds of visions, the amazing thing is that the Bible is the interpreter of itself, so it's not, you're not left in the dark, as it were. 25%, my best estimate, of the Bible is prophecy. So if you eliminate prophecy, you eliminate 25% of the biblical text. Also, one of the main teachers of prophecy is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, all the apostles in the New Testament are full of prophetic claims and promises. Actually, in the epistles, one of every 10 verses is about Jesus Christ returning. So I don't think we should lightly just throw it overboard, but that we should work at understanding this part of the Bible.
And I would add that by understanding the big story, as Dr. Norris has said, you understand the significance of Acts 2:38. Understand why it fits in with God's plan, why we should respond to it, and if we have responded to it, why we have hope for the future no matter what happens. So what happens in current events? So what are our fears? What are the predictions of the world? We have confidence that what we've experienced according to Acts 2:38 is going to be the key to whatever happens in the future. So I think a proper understanding of prophecy actually helps us understand who Jesus Christ is, which in turn helps us understand the significance of water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ and receiving the Spirit of Christ. So it makes sense of our present experience. And while you don't have to understand prophecy to obey Acts 2:38, I think understanding the big story, and which includes prophecy and includes the future, is a big part of maintaining our identity and persevering in the faith once we've received the experience.
One of the reasons why I think that a lot of people take the attitude that I just mentioned is because there's a lot of conflicting views on what specific Bible prophecies mean. I'd like both of you to weigh in on what are obviously there's disagreements out there, but what are the fundamental points of agreement that Oneness Pentecostals hold on the topic of Bible prophecy? What are the essentials that people need to believe?
You know, what's amazing is that not that there's so much diversity, but that there's so much sameness. In the first centuries of the church, a Christian church believed in the coming of Jesus Christ, the fact that there would be a tribulation period, a literal Antichrist would be coming, and they also believed in the future millennium of 1,000 years of peace that would usher in eternity. That was the universal belief of the early church. It wasn't until certain church fathers who were influenced by allegorical thinking and Platonic thought began to take the prophetic word and to turn it to mean something it never really said. For example, Clement of Alexandria and his intellectual successor Origen, they took prophecy because their idea was spiritual is better than physical and we can make this thing say what we want to say. The person who really codified it, who made it not a thing anymore, was a man by the name of Augustine. I remember reading in his City of God, book 7, book 20, chapter 7, where he says, you know, I used to believe in all this. I used to believe in the millennial, but then there's just too much carnal eating and drinking, you know, and he spiritualized everything. And so he made a turn and said, where it says, they lived and reigned, and it's a prophecy of the millennium. He said, well, that is, that's when you're converted. So he essentially allegorized the book of Revelation. Well, so that's why Catholics don't talk about a rapture. That's why Lutherans don't think of a millennium. That's why those, even the ones that were coming out of the Reformation, they didn't touch eschatology or prophecy whatsoever. It's only been in the last couple hundred years that prophecy goes back and says, you know what, let's skip church history. Let's figure out what the apostles believe. And so when we did that, what happened is, you know what, Jesus Christ is coming. He has a plan and we can be a part of that. And they began to expect for miracles and they began to expect ask the question, what does it mean to be in the bride of Christ? And so prophecy is actually in a certain way what gave birth, scholars would say, to the impetus that created the, and of course I know it was God, but that created the questions though that they're asking, created the modern Pentecostal movement. So when we say, well, is Jesus Christ coming pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, whatever, that winds up being like, for other people looking outside and looking at it like, it's a tempest in a teapot. It's just a small question. So in the main, I would say, at Oneness Apostolics, when you compare what all the things that we believe together have a very, very unified view of prophecy.
I would agree with that. And I would say the two things historically that gave rise to the modern Pentecostal movement, and again, we would say God is the one who guided us, but the two significant factors were teaching there is such a thing as the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the initial sign of speaking tongues, that's something everybody should seek if you believe on Jesus. And the second is the soon coming of the Lord. So the early pioneers of the 20th century felt that the Lord was coming soon, and in the last days, God will pour out His Spirit on all flesh. Joel prophesied a former rain and a latter rain. Peter picked that up. So the former rain was the day of Pentecost and the early centuries revival. The latter rain was what we're coming into. And so it was that prophetic view. And yes, when people talk about the differences in prophecy, they're talking about minute differences. And some people that focus almost exclusively on prophecy, I can see why people would get a little frustrated, because you got to believe, well, this beast means this, and this event means this, and this thing means this, and they have this whole detailed scheme, and nobody will probably agree with all aspects. But when you step back and look at the whole, we as Pentecostals, we're all looking for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the next great event for the church. We're all looking for the rapture, and regardless of the timing, our hope is the rapture of the church and the coming of Jesus Christ to earth. There will be a great time of tribulation before He establishes His kingdom. That He will establish His kingdom. We will rule and reign with Him. God will fulfill His prophecies to Israel and to the church. Whatever is left to be fulfilled, God will restore earth to His original plan. And then after that will be the last judgment, and there will be eternal reward for the righteous, the new heavens, the new earth, the new Jerusalem, and there will be eternal judgment for the unrighteous. So that's the big picture. And I think everything I just said, Oneness Pentecostals would agree on. The rest would be details. And while they can be important, we shouldn't lose sight of the big picture. And in fact, the book of Revelation is the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we Oneness Pentecostals emphasize it's showing Jesus Christ as the Lamb that was slain, but also the King who will come back and establish His kingdom. And in the end, we will see one on the throne, God revealed in the face of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ will rule for eternity, and we will be victorious with Him for eternity. That's the big picture. That's the main story. And that's what we all can and should agree on. And many other denominations don't even seem to have, as Dr. Norris said, a clear view of those big events.
I understand. So we brought up the rapture, the tribulation. I know there's some different schools of thought on exactly how all that's good, the timeline of all that, when the rapture is going to happen in relation to the tribulation. Can you just walk us through what the different points of view are, and maybe the background of those points of view?
Absolutely. When Pentecostalism first began, there was less diversity, actually. Every Pentecostal believed that Jesus Christ would come, and then after that would be a great tribulation. But since that time, others have gravitated to different views. One view is that Jesus Christ will come in the middle of the tribulation, and or pre-wrath, sometimes it varies. But in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, it's speaking about the prophetic events that will happen. And it outlines a period of some 7 years. Then he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. That's a week of years. All scholars agree on this. And in the middle of the week, he'll bring an end to sacrifice and offerings. So you have this week of 7 years, and then you have some things that happen in the first half of that week and some things that happen in the second half of that week. And it's said in different ways. In Daniel 7:25, it calls it time, times, and half a time. So that's 3.5 years. Or say in Daniel 12:7, the same language is used, a half time, times, and half a time. Whereas in verse 11, it says it's 1,290 days, which again, essentially 3.5 years. The book of Revelation takes that 7 year period from Daniel, and it becomes a skeleton for what happens in Revelation chapter 6 through Revelation chapter 19. And again, it uses those same schemas. It will talk about the same beasts. It will talk about the same kinds of language. For example, in Revelation chapter 11 and verse 3, it says there's going to be two prophets, and the prophesies 1,260 days, same as Daniel. Or in the previous verse, it says 42 months. Again, that's 3.5 years. You got the same language in Revelation 12:6 and in Revelation 12:14, and you've got it again in Revelation 13. So it's there. It's there in Daniel. So you have 7 years, and then you have 3.5 years. Well, some will say, well, maybe God's wrath starts in the 3.5 years, and the rest is sort of something else, a peace or whatever. So that's a mid-tribulation perspective. A post-tribulation perspective, and you could get this if, say, you just read, let's say, the Olivet Discourse in a certain way. So it looks like, well, maybe Jesus Christ is coming at the end. And so there are some people say, well, when he's coming with his saints in Revelation 19, what must be assumed is that they already went up and then they came down, even though it's not said. And it's very hard to find a rapture in the book of Revelation anyway. My perspective, and again, I respect all opinions. I think it's a legitimate thing for people to have a disagreement on this and all that sort of thing. So, but what drives me is the number of scriptures that talk about wrath and how God doesn't really want us to be in wrath. So let me give you an example. Ephesians chapter 5. Paul writes in verses 5 and 6. He says that if you're someone is a fornicator, an unclean person, a covetous man, or an adulterer, he has no place in the kingdom of God and of Christ. And then he says in verse 6, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. The same thing is said in Colossians chapter 3. And we look for the Lord Jesus Christ come, verse 4, and then verse 5 says, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desires. Again, verse 6, because of these things, the wrath of God comes on the sons of disobedience. All right, so it specifically focuses on that group of people. There are other texts that actually say that the church is not appointed to wrath. For example, Romans chapter 5, we know scarcely for a righteous man will die, prevent your good man, some would even dare to die. God demonstrates his love towards us while we are sinners, Christ died for us. Then verse 9 of chapter 5, it says that we are not only justified by his blood, but we're saved by wrath through him, from wrath through him. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 10, Paul writes, to look for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18, it gives a wonderful promise of the rapture. And then in chapter 5, again, it's sequential. You have what I would believe is the tribulation. Most scholars would tell you that. But in verse 9 of chapter 5, it says that God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. And finally, in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 10, Paul writes to the church of Philadelphia, and he says, because you've kept my command to persevere, I will also keep you from the hour of trial, which will come upon the earth, and which all scholars that I've read will tell you that that's the tribulation period. So it's not just one simple proof text. It seems to be the tenor of the New Testament promises. So how I read that is that we won't have to endure the wrath that God has. The word wrath there is synonymous with the word great tribulation.
And I would agree with Dr. Norris, and I would just paraphrase what he said and put it in a few different words. So there's this view of the pre, mid, and post tribulation. So I think the post tribulation comes if you simply read the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, Paul, Christ's discussion on the Mount of Olives, which Dr. Norris mentioned, the Olivet Discourse. So at that time, it was before the day of Pentecost, the disciples did not have a clear understanding of the church and that Jews and Gentiles would be united in the church. It wouldn't be based on the law of Moses. It would be based on the new covenant. And so Jesus made the comment, you see this beautiful temple, well, this is going to be completely destroyed. Well, naturally, the disciples, as Jewish partisans, they were thinking in terms of Messiah is going to drive out the Romans, establish a kingdom on earth pretty soon. We're going to rule with him on his right hand, left hand, and this is going to be great. So what do you mean the temple is going to be destroyed? And for them, that was synonymous with the end of the age because they couldn't imagine this triumphal messianic kingdom and the temple lying in ruins. And so they said, well, what's going to be the sign of this happening and of the end of the age? And they conflated that. And Jesus didn't take the time to try to unravel their thinking, but he just answered. And in when you read Luke, it seems he's answering more of what's going to happen when the Romans destroy the temple in AD 70. But then Matthew, he seems to use those events to foreshadow the events of the end time. So he didn't clearly say, just like he, you know, we talked about the former reign, the latter reign, the Holy Spirit. Well, there's an initial fulfillment of prophecy of the desolate temple, and then there's an ultimate fulfillment. And he didn't explain the gap, and he didn't distinguish between the two. He just answered their questions. So if you just read that, you're really coming from a pre-Pentecost, pre-church perspective. There is no clear statement of the rapture. And so I think most people that get the post-tribulation view, they primarily look at the synoptic gospels, the Olivet Discourse, and they don't really see a rapture. They just see the Lord coming back to earth. Okay, so at the end, everybody rises up in the air, meets the Lord in the air, and comes right back down. That's the post-tribulation rapture. However, even in that, in Luke 21:28, when Jesus gives the various signs of the end, he says, when all these things begin to come to pass, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. So I would tie in with Dr. Norris that he's telling all these horrible things will happen, but he says, you're not going to have to go through all of this. You're just going to go through the beginning, and you're going to be look up. And to me, that's an implied statement of the rapture. You're going to meet the Lord in the air. Now, the mid-tribulation view, as Dr. Norris said, there are some statements in Daniel and Revelation that show this seven, most people see this great tribulation or this tribulation period of 7 years in the future. And it does appear that that Revelation 6 through 19 describes it. And you could argue the first half of that is the wrath of man. So in essence, God says, I'm going to withdraw my church. I'm going to withdraw the work of my spirit, and I'll let humans do whatever they're big enough to do. They've been wanting to have their own way all throughout history. I will give them the ultimate chance to rule the world without me and without the church to prove it's not going to be utopia. It's going to be devastation. It's unprecedented. Just like the fascist and the communists of the 20th century, they thought they would bring utopia. Instead, they brought mass destruction. And so the first half of the tribulation seems to be the Antichrist is warring and setting up his kingdom, which brings famine and pestilence and death. And that's all caused by humans. But then the second half of this time, God begins to pour out his wrath directly. So that's the mid-trib view to me doesn't have a lot of strong exegetical or specific scriptural support, but it's more based on this concept. Well, God will let the church go through the tribulation times that are caused by humans. But when God starts directly pouring out his wrath, then he takes the church out. I do think that's not as strong of an argument, because even though the beginning of the tribulation is instigated by the evils of humans, it's still God, like as Romans 1 says, God turns people over to the consequences. Well, that's still devastating judgment on the human race due to sinful humans in charge. Now, the pre-trib rapture, as Dr. Norris mentioned, I want to just make a comment here. Some people say there really is no rapture. But you have 1 Thessalonians 4, which he mentioned. You also have 1 Corinthians 15, which are very clear that we're going to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. We'll be changed from mortal to immortality in the twinkling of an eye. The dead in Christ will rise. Those who are alive at that time will rise to meet the Lord, to meet them, and we'll all meet the Lord in the air. So I think you have two very clear, detailed passages in 1 Thessalonians 4, 15 through 17, 1 Corinthians 15, around what, 50, 52?
51.
What, 51, yeah. 52, that are very clear that there is an actual literal rapture. And some people point out, well, the word rapture isn't in Scripture. Rapture is from the Latin meaning caught up. So the word caught up is in Scripture. So if you want to say the catching away of the saints, that's 100% scriptural. If you want to use rapture as a shorthand label for the catching away of the saints, I see no problem to that. Now, the pre-trib view would be God is taking us, the church, out before the wrath. And so I mentioned Luke. Dr. Norris mentions a number of verses, and I do think the Thessalonians discussion is very clear because 1 Thessalonians 4 talks about the rapture. Chapter 5 says, you know, God is not appointed to wrath. And then if you go to 2 Thessalonians, it says this day is not going to come this is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And so after reading 1 Thessalonians, apparently some of the Thessalonians believers thought, oh no, maybe the rapture already took place and I missed it. Maybe the Lord already came and I didn't know it. An allegorical view, you know, we're living in the days of the Lord and where is he and what's this going to be and am I a part of it? And so Paul explains, well, wait a minute. That day of the Lord is not going to come until the restraining force is taken out of the way. And then after the restraining force is taken away, then the Antichrist or the man of sin, the beast, will be revealed. He will establish his kingdom. And then Jesus Christ will come back to earth in judgment. So there seems to be a sequence, the removing of the restrainer, the revelation of this evil man, and then Jesus Christ coming back to earth to establish his kingdom. The restraining force, what would it be? The church or maybe the Holy Spirit working in the church. So it does seem there's a key event that has to happen before and then the tribulation. And then finally, I would say, if you look at Revelation 4 as basically chronological, now maybe, you know, in details, it may loop around or have references back and forth. But in Revelation 1, Jesus appears to John. And in verse 19, he says, I want you to write the things you've seen, the things that are, and the things are to come. If you see that as a basic chronology, the things you've seen, that's Jesus Christ appearing to John in chapter 1. The things which are, the situation of the churches of his day, which is described by the seven churches, the seven representative churches in Revelation 2 and 3. Then chapter 4, he's caught up in the Spirit to heaven. And you could see that as maybe prefiguring the rapture because he's caught up to heaven. He sees redeemed saints worshiping. And then down on earth, he sees this evil ruler, which we're calling the Antichrist, being revealed. And as I've already outlined, the human evil and then divine judgment. And so it looks like the saints are worshiping God in heaven while all the tribulation events are happening on earth. So by implication, that would be the rapture. And then in the midst of that, there's the marriage supper of the Lamb. And then Jesus comes back to earth with his saints in Revelation 19. So it seems that the saints, while all these evil things are terrible things, destructive things and judgment happening on earth, the saints are worshiping God in heaven and enjoying the marriage supper of the Lamb. And so the book of Revelation, I would argue, likewise indicates that the pre-tribulation rapture is the most likely explanation. Now, I would hasten to add, in the United Pentecostal Church International, we allow diversity of views. We don't require you to have one certain view to hold ministerial credentials. I would say historically, the overwhelming majority of our ministers have believed in the pre-tribulation rapture, much as I've described. In recent years, I think with people becoming more studious and exposed to different spectrum views across Christendom, people pick up things from here and there, and there's probably an increasing diversity to some extent, but probably most ministers haven't carefully studied it out to have a strong conclusion otherwise. But I think instinctively, and I think we should preach, the Lord can come at any time. I don't think we should preach, well, there's got to be 7 years, 3.5 years. You know, the Lord couldn't come. Regardless of my prophetic scheme, I may not be 100% correct. I need to expect, and really, Titus 2:13, the hope of the church is we're looking for the appearing of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So it's not saying, well, you know, you're going to go through 7 years of tribulation and then you're going to look for the coming of the Lord. It's the implication is the Lord can come at any time and deliver you out of your current circumstances. And of course, we all know that can happen by death. So we better be ready for that. But I think there is the indication that we should be prepared for the Lord to come for the church at any time. And that is our hope. Whatever's going on, if it seems that we're getting ready to have a nuclear war, well, we don't have to wait 7 years after that for deliverance. Jesus Christ could come at any moment and deliver us. And I think that is probably the strong majority of our ministers and believers would still hold that expectation of the coming of the Lord.
And as Dr. Norris alluded to in his answer earlier, that impetus of feeling like the rapture is going to happen anytime was a major impetus of the early Pentecostal movement.
Because the idea was you need to receive the Holy Ghost if you want to go up in the rapture. So again, it wasn't, well, see these events, you got 7 years to receive the Holy Ghost. No, you better receive the Holy Ghost now because the Lord can come at any time.
Yeah. Growing up in the United Pentecostal Church, I certainly remember that feeling even as a kid, that being stressed, you need to be ready. So we talked a lot about the Great Tribulation, and maybe people out there are wondering what exactly we're talking about when you use that term. What will the Great Tribulation be like? What's the Bible say about that?
Well, the term originally comes from Daniel. In Daniel chapter 12 and verse 1, it says, "At that time Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people." Then the next phrase, it says, "And there shall be a time of trouble, such as not been since the world began, or since there was a nation even to that time." In the Septuagint, when it's translated into Greek, Jesus picks up that phrase from Daniel chapter 12, and in the Olivet Discourse, Matthew chapter 24, chapter 25, he says in verse 21, he says, "There shall be a time of great tribulation, such as never been since the world was, no, nor ever shall be." So great tribulation is in the words and the mouth of Jesus. In the book of Revelation, it also uses that same language. In Revelation chapter 7, one of the elders asks John, "Who are these in the white robes? Where did they come from?" And John said, "Sir, you know." So he said, "These are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them a white in the blood of the Lamb." They're essentially martyrs that he sees. And so what happens in the great tribulation is, again, if I'm correct, and Daniel is the template, which I believe it is, there's a seven-year period of wrath. There are essentially three sets of seven plagues. There's seven, what we call seals. Each time the Lamb takes off the seal from the scroll, another judgment happens. And then there's the next set of plagues where the seven trumpets blow, and each time the trumpets blow, there is a judgment that happens. And then finally there's the vials, or the bowls really, that are poured out. And the thing about the book of Revelation, it is an increasing amount of intensity of judgment. So in the seals, a fourth of the earth is affected, and possibly that many people are killed. In the trumpets, a third of the earth is affected. And when you read the bowls, it's like the sea is turned to blood. I mean, it's like, it's people who have thumbed their noses in the eyes of God and said, I can do it. I don't need you. And what the tribulation period is a cleansing. It's God reclaiming the earth. He gets no pleasure from judgment. I read in the 1960s of a couple of doctors who wanted to cure childhood lymphoma. And this cancer was terrible. Most of the children were dying. They started giving poisons. Well, maybe we can get it with this poison and that poison, and nothing was working. And they got the idea, let's put all the poisons together and have a certain regimen. And nobody wanted to be a part of that. But ultimately, it was successful, and it's what we call chemotherapy today. And that sounds like a terrible thing that you would do, but the intent is not for harm, but the intent is to redeem the earth. In the book of Revelation, chapter 11, there's a prophetic announcement that this is the time when he's going to redeem the saints and the prophets and destroy those who destroy the earth. It's not that God is destroying the earth. He is cleansing the earth. And as terrible as that judgment is, it's not the end of the world, it's the beginning of a new age when God's will reign supreme, when the earth will be in the way that God intended it.
And I would just add, God is holy, and so he cannot have fellowship with sin. God is righteous and just. He always does what is right. And we notice that in the time of the flood, people became so evil that God had to cleanse the earth. We notice the Tower of Babel, when people so disobeyed God that he had to scatter the people. And in the Tower of Babel, he said, we have to do this, I think speaking to the angels, or nothing will restrain them. They'll keep doing it. And likewise in the flood, the imagination of people, evil continue. So there's a sense, if I don't put a stop to this, this is going to get worse and worse and worse, and it's going to totally destroy my original creative intention. And I think we see this as a society. I've made the point that our society is now trying to roll back Genesis 2 and Genesis 1. So our society is attacking what it means for a godly marriage through promiscuity and various forms of sexual relationships outside of marriage. Well, then they're now destroying the very concept of man and woman being married with same-sex marriage. And then now they're destroying what it means to be a man and a woman. And then finally, they're attacking what it means to be human when we promote abortion, and now some are promoting infanticide because, some children are born with defects that are unknown, and we would have aborted them 2 days before, so let's say we can kill them two days afterwards. And then euthanasia and granting, because great apes have mental capacities like a newborn would, then we have to give them rights that we would give humans. And we can't be discriminatory against species. That would be speciesism. So we're deconstructing what it means to be a human being. Well, how far back? And then people are wanting to implant devices in their brains to improve their mental powers, the whole transhumanism movement. And so now we're deconstructing what it means to be human. Well, where, how much further can you go back? You're in Genesis 1. So it seems like at some point soon, God has to say, if he's going to be true to his own character and his own creative intention, he has to say, I have to put a stop to this and I have to cleanse the earth. And so, as I said earlier, I think it's a final demonstration. Okay, humans, I'm going to give you a limited time to give you over to what you've asked for. If you read Romans 1, this would be like the last step. Okay, I'm letting you do everything you're big enough to do, and it's going to bring its own judgment, and then I will step in. And perhaps one other point from a prophetic point of view is God will use this time of great tribulation to bring the Jews to an awareness that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. Because the Jewish people will stand against that. Even those who don't know the Lord, they believe in one God, they're going to see what I just said. And they're going to say, we're not going to be part of this. And the Antichrist will attempt to crush them and establish his dominion in Jerusalem. And then the Lord will come in the Battle of Armageddon. So that will be a time for Israel as a nation to have the opportunity to recognize who Jesus really is. And so that's another theme of the tribulation. So I do believe it's a 7-year period that's in the future. The church will be caught up. The sinful world will undergo it. But there will be people who come out of that tribulation, and it may be primarily Jewish people who turn to Jesus Christ as their Messiah.
You just mentioned the Antichrist. Of course, that's a character that plays a large role in the end times. What does the Bible actually say about him? And can you unpack that for us?
Yes. As Brother Bernard alluded to, sometimes in prophecy, you'll start talking about one thing and then you'll talk about another. So for example, he's talking about what's going to happen with the Romans, and then he sees the ultimate cosmic destruction. Same thing happens in the Old Testament with regard to the Antichrist. For example, in Revelation chapter 11, there's this whole prophetic declaration of generation after generation until you get to a guy by the name of Antiochus IV, or we would call him Antiochus Epiphanes. He lived in the second century BC, and he was one of the most terrible individuals, wanted to stomp out Jewish religion. And as it's beginning to talk about him, it starts talking in a way that's not him. It's just started talking about cosmic. So like in Daniel 11:36, he shall magnify and exalt himself above all that is called God or his worship, and that he'll blaspheme the God of gods, and he'll prosper till the wrath has been accomplished. He won't show regard to any god or women or anything. And verse 36, he'll exalt themselves above them all. It's interesting that Paul takes this very verse, and to understand that it's cosmic, when you get down a couple of verses, we're seeing the dead rise. So it's, we've moved from Antiochus, we've moved to the cosmic end. And Paul says, he calls him the man of sin, son of perdition, and in 2 Thessalonians 2:4, he says, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or there's worship. Again, quoting this very text, so that he as God sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So if you take Daniel 9:27, it looks like he's going to try to do this peace thing. And there are a lot of different world religions that have some place for a Messiah. So things are going to get combined. You say, well, how did Muslims and Christians get together in this? Well, it depends what you mean, get together, because there's some sort of notion of a world leader, Messiah, that's going to have some religious base and flavoring and this whole, sometimes called a harlot church, whatever. It's a religious theme that comes together and sets himself up. And then ultimately, he'll turn on that and say, well, you know what? Actually, I'm going to rule and reign. I'm God. And it's... he's going to set himself up in the temple, and that's a pretty big claim. He'll start doing things like, and we already see how the money system can be controlled. We already see how that things are crashing down, so that there's this, all this globalism came together. I saw last week where a group met and in the Middle East, and they're proposing a digital currency, a one world digital currency. So it's on the horizon. So he's going to do all these things to control the earth and ultimately make people surrender their sovereignty, and it would be an act of worship, to worship him.
So what you see in Daniel, the wicked king that rises up, which you really see as the end time king, and then in 2 Thessalonians, the man of sin, son of perdition, and then Revelation, the beast, which is a kingdom but also a person, you can see. And so all those are connected. Those texts do not use the term Antichrist, but that is from 1 John, which talks about the spirit of Antichrist is already working. But I think that term has become popular because that's exactly what he is. He is a ruler that's a false Christ. And Jesus certainly did mention in the Olivet Discourse, there would be false Christs or false messiahs. And so he is the Antichrist. He is the exact opposite of Christ, who pretends to be Christ. And even as we believe Jesus Christ is the one true God manifest in the flesh, God incarnate, he is going to proclaim himself as God incarnate. So he is going to be not the true Christ, but the Antichrist. So I think that's a very apt term for this evil human ruler of the end time that's going to attempt to control the whole world that you see in a number of these prophetic texts that we've just mentioned. And you do see, say, in Revelation 17 and Revelation 18, all the religions of the world combining to support this Antichrist. And then all the economic systems of the world combining to support this Antichrist. And one thing that I want to make, you know, people, whenever there's a great event, people always jump, well, is this the fulfillment of this particular prophecy? And I've seen that all my life, and I've even seen that in studying before. Well, you know, World War I came, or when Mussolini rose to power, or then when Hitler rose to power, then World War II, then the communism, and Gorbachev, and then the Iraq War, the first war, and the Gulf War, you know, every time. Well, this is the prophecy. I think that's a mistake to try to identify that. But I think there's a broader point that's true in that every time in human history, godly people have expected these things. Even Paul spoke in terms of we which are alive and remain. So he was hoping he might be alive in the rapture. Now, was he wrong? No, he was not wrong, because I believe God's believers in every generation should expect the coming of the Lord. But it turned out his hope wasn't fulfilled. So every generation has had that hope. But what's different is we can actually see how the prophecies could literally be fulfilled in a moment's time. So previous generations could believe the text, but they had no clue or explanation of how that could be implemented. They just had to trust that prophecy was accurate. We can actually see, yes. And so I remember when Iraq invaded Kuwait and President George Bush, H.W. Bush, rallied the whole world to conquer to deliver Kuwait. And here was a global war in the Middle East. So some thought this was a fulfillment of prophecy. My point was no. But what it shows is that literally overnight, all the nations of the world could be in a war in the Middle East. So Revelation is not some fantasy book. Revelation, we could wake up tomorrow morning and the headlines could be one world government or one world economic system or one world religion or a global war or decisive war in the Middle East. You know, we could understand when the beast has an image that speaks. Well, previous generations could not understand that. We literally could understand through the internet.
Right.
I think what was it like? Something like 2 billion people watched the funeral of Princess Diana or something like that. So literally the whole world could watch in real time the Antichrist speaking. You know, the whole world talking about the economic system. The whole world could be wrapped up in one economic system. Now, there can be individuals off the grid, maybe even nations that were refused to submit. But the process by which this could all be done, everything in the book of Revelation could easily be fulfilled in a matter of, what, say months or, you know, short period of time.
Yes, absolutely. Both of you have alluded in your responses to what Revelation 13 calls the mark of the beast. I don't know that it necessarily uses that language, that term, but what is the mark? Can you explain what the Bible has to say about that particular subject?
In Revelation chapter 13, starting with verse 11, there's a second beast that's introduced. And we do get him identified later with the language of false prophet. But he performs great signs, verse 13, makes fire come down from heaven. He deceives those who look at these miracles, and he's granted power to, he tells the nations, verse 14, to make an image to the beast. Verse 15, he's granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak, and causes many who view this to have to take the image of the beast. And then verse 16 to 18 is the most purposeful language. He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead, and that no one may buy or sell unless he has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666. Let me just say a couple things about the book of Revelation. Like the Olivet Discourse, where Jesus could speak to that generation which he was living, and then also speak to the cosmic end. So some of the book of Revelation is speaking directly to things for those churches. And it's using the language of Rome and the imagery of Rome and some things that are actually going on in the first century. So there's pieces of that. Some would say there's gematria, Nero is going on here, Nero, Caesar, whatever. Gematria, you can make that dance on its head. I'm not sure that's Nero, Caesar, but my only point is whatever Rome was, as terrible as Rome was, that's not the limitation or the end of this prophecy. This prophecy is about something so severe, it is almost, it's very, very difficult to just imagine it. Rule of thumb in Revelation is take it literal unless you can't take it literal. No, that's not always even, it's not always easy to do. So when you say a mark on your right hand or on your forehead, what does that look like? You know, people thought Gorbachev's mark was the mark, or there have been all different things. So the book of Revelation invites us to read ourselves into it. You have to be cautious in that. You can't say, well, this is the thing. And once you do that, usually about 10 years later, you find out it wasn't the thing. But if we were to read ourselves, it wouldn't be hard to do that. We have this capability of scanning now, where something in implanting chips and doing this, that, or the other thing, it's not impossible that this could be implanted in someone's forehead or in his hand. So from a technological standpoint, that could be what the mark of the beast is. I'm not saying it is, but I'm saying that would be a way we could read ourselves into the book of Revelation.
And I would add to that, Yes, we generally take the whole Bible at face value, as literally as the circumstances warrant, no, much like human speech, ordinary human speech. So we take the Bible according to its grammatical and historical meaning, which means it's a relatively literal interpretation, unless the context itself indicates, well, this is a figure of speech, or this is a parable, or this is a symbol of something. And of course, in prophetic language, you more often have symbols because you're dealing with the unknown. So you're trying to relate future events in terms that the people of that time could relate to. So they couldn't relate to computers or video technology. So obviously, if the Bible is referring to something like that, it would have to be done in a symbolic way that would have made sense to the people of the first century. So I do think when you approach the Bible that way, it's a whole way of interpreting the Bible as ordinary speech as much as possible. That's how I would say it, unless the context itself indicates that it's symbolic speech. So when you do that, it talks about taking a mark that would be a sign of allegiance to the beast, the sign of worshiping the beast. So first of all, it wouldn't be something you accidentally do and you didn't realize it was. No, you know the significance. You are pledging your allegiance to the beast. You're worshiping the Antichrist as God. You know what you're doing because you're taking a deliberate pledge. Now, if you try to do it as literally as possible, I would tend to say it's going to be a literal mark on your hand or forehead, because otherwise, why would it mention those bodily parts? If it's allegorical saying, oh, you're pledging allegiance, why wouldn't it just say so? And why would it say the right hand or the left hand or the toe? Or, you know, why is it that specific? You tend to think it's specific because it's going to be real, not a metaphor. But again, you're talking about first century, they wouldn't have known about chips. So it's very possible it could be a tattoo that could be scanned, could be a chip that's implanted and scanned. So yeah, that would be one way, and that would be a way of implementing a worldwide economic system using current technology. So I think something like that is very likely to be the implementation. I would also say, however, people sometimes jump to conclusions, say, well, we should ban all chips because that's going to be the mark of the beast. Well, there are a lot of things that could prepare the way or be a precursor. But if you're going to do that, well, video technology, well, computers, well, chips, you know, you go down the list. Cell phones can track you. So if you're really going to take that seriously and you don't want anything that the Antichrist is going to use, you're going to have to unplug from the real world. But I don't think we have to worry. Number one, I do believe the rapture is coming. So no, we're not going to compromise with sin, but we're not going to live in fear of, well, I can't use a computer, or I can't use video technology, I can't use a cell phone, I can't use a chip, a credit card with a chip, because, you know, the Antichrist is going to probably use that. Well, we're going to be gone. But I think we draw the line when there's something that we're voluntarily pledging allegiance to a false system. Now, I would personally, of course, I don't believe Christians should get tattoos anyway, but I would personally say an implanted chip for the purpose of reading my financial information, to me, that's too uncomfortably close. But unplugging from the economic system of the world, I think that's unnecessary. Because again, our focus is not being afraid of the Antichrist. Our focus is the coming of Jesus Christ. And so I think we don't have to live in fear that we would accidentally take the mark and without our knowing it, we wake up one day and we're doomed to eternal lake of fire because we didn't know what was going on. No, I think there'll be a clear choice, and whoever's here at that time will knowingly make such a choice.
Jumping from Revelation 13 to Revelation chapter 20, which tells us that the devil eventually is going to be bound for 1,000 years and that then he'll be loosed for a little season. This is Revelation 21 through 3. What does all that mean? The devil's bound, then he's loosed for a little season. How would you interpret that?
Well, in Revelation 6 to 19, chapter 19 culminates with what we sometimes call the Battle of Armageddon. You have Jesus on this white horse and you have a battle, which doesn't seem to be much of a battle. It looks like it's over pretty quick. And at that point, we have the kingdom of God comes in stages. So Jesus could speak to to the present about the kingdom of God. And in a sense, it was fulfilled. It's fulfilled in the church, and in a sense, it's fulfilled. And then there's going to be the kingdom where the wolf lies down with the lamb and all of that. And that's going to be in that 1,000-year period that comes up. In that same time, Satan is bound. And the Bible gives a principle from the book of Isaiah that the kingdom of God increases. So it's not like, all right, he's got a place for the church, now he's got a place for the Jews. No, it's simply that the kingdom of God is increasing. You got the church, and then you've got the conversion of the Jewish nation, and it all gets added together, and it gets closer and closer to that redemptive plan that God has for the telos, for the end, for the happily ever after. So Satan is bound in a bottomless pit. Verse 1, I saw an angel coming down from heaven, had a key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, the servant of all, and cast him in a bottomless pit and shut him up and set him a seal on him. And he's sealed for 1,000 years. Then after the 1,000 years, there's going to be this time where Satan is loosed. And okay, so first of all, a lot of times people say, you know, that I was going to do this, but the devil made me do something else. Well, maybe it was the devil. But James tells us, you know, every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. So we kind of have something to do with temptation. But if you have this righteous milieu where everyone's righteous, where Jesus Christ is literally ruling and reigning, you might have some thoughts of sin, but you're going to probably keep those privately to yourself. But God always gives a choice. It's free will. He doesn't make, my sister had a little chatty Kathy doll, you pulled the string and it said, God doesn't want that. He wants us to freely choose. And so he's going to give one more chance. Are you going to really serve me or not serve me? And so when Satan is released again, it won't be a long time, but he'll be able to capture those who had evil thoughts, and there's going to be one last battle, and then Satan will be sent to the lake of fire where the beast and the false prophet are. So that's my sense of what's going on there. So
I would say, I agree. I would just like to add a little bit. So the saved of the ages who are resurrected in their glorified bodies, we will rule and reign with Christ. So we won't have temptation. We're past that. We've already made our choice. We've been transformed. But apparently at the Battle of Armageddon, as I said, there's a battle set up between people who are favoring the Antichrist, people who are opposing the Antichrist. So there's got to be at least a few people left that refuse to bow down to him, that are fighting against him. And they will continue to live into the millennium, it appears to me. And then there will be some people born during the millennium. So as Dr. Norris says, there will be unregenerated people, or unglorified people, not us, but people who live their natural lives in the millennium. But there'll be very little temptation, certainly no external temptation from the devil. And so this wraps up this wonderful... I think the millennium is God's way of fulfilling his plan for the earth originally and fulfilling his plan to the nation of Israel. All the promises that haven't been fulfilled will be fulfilled. So it's kind of like God wrapping up. But still, sin exists. And so there's one final chance for people to decide, am I going to serve God of my free will, or am I going to give in to my sinful inclinations? And that will end, of course, again, very quickly with the battle of Gog and Magog, with that last battle, which will then wrap up the earth as we know it with the last judgment.
You mentioned the last judgment. If you read on in Revelation chapter 20, it talks about the great white throne judgment. Can you just explain what that means and what's going to happen at the great white throne judgment?
Yes, in verse 11 of Revelation chapter 20, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it. Before his face, the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God. And the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to the things which were written in the books. So this is God's final end of everyone that's going to come and appear before him. Now, there's a little caveat. We'll be raptured. We're not going to be at the white throne judgment as being judged again. We are judged at the cross. And when we are raptured, there's a kind of a judgment. We'll see Jesus. There'll be what was called the judgment seat of Christ, Romans 14:10, 2 Corinthians 5:10. But it's more of a giving of rewards, of a faithfulness of the saints. And Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, some of them were going to law with each other. And he was trying to admonish them. And he says, don't you know that the saints will judge the world? And then in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians 6, he says, don't you know we'll judge angels? So at the white throne judgment, we'll be there, but we've already been declared righteous by God. We'll be there, I would say, as part of God's heavenly court. God will sort it out. You know, sometimes you look at the world and you go like, that's not fair. And then you think something should turn out right and it turns wrong. And then you see something that's just like terrible abuse or terrible, and you think like, how does any of this make sense? And I'll tell you this, it doesn't make sense a lot of times in time. It'll only make sense in eternity. God's a righteous judge. He's a good God. He's a merciful God. And in that day, every person will have to acknowledge the wonder of who God is and his mercy and his love. And so I don't see this just as a judgment, but I see this as God's final redemptive act to bring in eternal life for everyone.
Yes, I think the saints, the believers, are judged at the cross, so we'll never face our sins. They're washed away. We repented. We believed in Jesus. Jesus paid the price. We'll never face the shame and humiliation and sorrow and judgment because we sorrow now when we repent. I do. 1 Corinthians 3 talks about a judgment seat of Christ where nobody will be lost, but they'll be given rewards. Now, how that will happen, I'm not completely sure. Maybe the marriage supper of the Lamb, maybe the rewards will pertain to the millennial kingdom. Because I think in eternity, there's not going to be different classes of people. I think we'll all be blessed. But I do believe there's going to be a time of reward according to our work. So things we've done for the kingdom of God will be rewarded. Things we just did in pursuit of our personal goals, they're not sinful, but they won't be rewarded. So it appears that the great white throne judgment, the only people left to be judged are the sinners. And so you might say, well, why? Because God is fair. God will give everyone an account, give opportunity for everyone. Not that anybody can escape, but he will lay out the just basis for their sentence. Also, I think, you know, some people, justice is never done in this life. Adolf Hitler committed suicide. He chose his own exit. Joseph Stalin died a natural death. He never paid for his crimes. Mao never paid for his crimes. But the great white throne judgment, the crimes and sins of everyone will be exposed for what they are in the sight of all humanity. And then they will receive a just punishment. Now, again, I don't know exactly what that means, but Luke 12 talks about the servant that knew his master's will and disobeyed is beaten with many stripes. The servant that didn't know his master's will but still did wrong is beaten with a few stripes. Jesus also said, I think in Matthew 11, that, you know, Sodom and Gomorrah would have repented had they had someone like Jesus to come preach for them. It'd be better. It's going to be better for them in judgment, more tolerable for them in judgment than for the cities of Galilee that had the ministry of Christ and rejected it. Now, again, I don't think anybody's saved without the cross and without the plan of salvation. And in our day, of course, the new birth experience is our plan of salvation. But I do believe there is going to be some fairness in judgment, that people will be judged according to their works. And so there will be a distribution of different types of judgment. And even if that is primarily people's own mental anguish and agony and shame and humiliation, well, that would be part of the judgment for them to be exposed to the whole world. It is a part of administering judgment. So after that last judgment, the saved of the ages will live eternally in the presence of the Lord, the new heaven, the new earth, the new Jerusalem, and the sinners, the unrepentant sinners, the unbelievers, they will have eternal judgment, which is spoken of as the lake of fire. So that will be the outcome of the last judgment.
Tell us a little bit about that new heaven and new earth, which is mentioned in Revelation 21. What does the scripture say about that? And who's going to live there?
Well, Revelation 21 verses 1 through 8 are really a foreshadowing of eternity, and it does so in glorious language. We have different word pictures in other parts of Revelation, but it's the superlative. I mentioned before, God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, or sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. I don't know. It doesn't mean we won't have emotions. It doesn't mean we're going to sit on a cloud and have eternal state of nothing. You know, when I read the book of Psalms, because sometimes people say, well, I'm just going to be glorifying Jesus in eternity, a 24/7 shout down or something like that. When I read the book of Psalms, the book that most gives laud to God, there's a lot of other things going on in Psalms. And when you really look at it from our perspective, God is still concerned about us. And there's always doing and acting, and there's always some sort of thing that God has planned for us. So I think part of the idea of heaven as this eternal bliss comes from transporting Plato and his ideal realm and making that heaven. I think God's got some pretty exciting things for us in eternity. We have glimpses and pieces and suggestions, but it's going to be incredible. I don't think we can even begin to imagine all of that what God has for us. But if this is good, if the best of this world, a good marriage, the finest of love of a mother to a child, or whatever other metaphors are used of that, if this world's best is just an inkling of that day, it's something I can hardly wait.
Amen. I look at it like this. I believe God will renovate the earth and renovate heaven, and the New Jerusalem will be a city, which it appears it is like a satellite or hovering over or maybe on the new earth. I'm not really sure of the details, but the saved of all the ages will have access to the new heaven, new earth, New Jerusalem, presence of God, visible presence of Jesus Christ in our relationship with Him. And we can't imagine eternity, because you think, well, for a billion years I can enjoy this, but after a billion years I might get tired of this. So then what? We can't comprehend that. But I look at it like this. Before there was sin in the human race, God created Adam. He said it isn't good for the man to be alone, so He created the woman. So there was already a plan for procreation and multiple families, relationships before sin. And then God planted a garden, and He put Adam in the garden and said to tend this, to keep it. So before there was sin, God had a job for Adam to do. He's active to participate in tending that creation. If you think about it, if you just had left a garden to nature, it would quickly just disintegrate into weeds and chaos. So God has a plan for humans to take care of His creation and, maybe not be co-creators, but be partners with Him in bringing out the best in creation. Think about crops and plants and animals and pets, and how we humans have shaped plants and animals in the to be like, it could be like a garden, an idyllic place of harmony. And so I do believe, if you look at those two things that are before sin, relationships and achievement, work, accomplishment. So I do believe God has plans for us. And I like to look at it this way. Astronomers say there are trillions of stars, which implies trillions of planets. I don't know if we'll be involved in those. I don't know maybe if God will create a future race and we'll help Him minister like the angels do, or I don't know. But I'm just saying, if God has created trillions of stars and planets that we didn't even know about until recently, doesn't that signify in some way God has big plans for us? They're so big, even in the natural, we can't explain them. And we can't even understand that. I could say trillions of stars. I think one estimate was a septillion stars. Well, what does that even mean? We can say the words and we can write the zeros on paper, but we don't know what we're talking about. That to me is just a hint of the grandeur of God's plan, even looking at this physical universe. And then if you think of the spirit realm of angels and what could be beyond our universe that can't be comprehended in the physical universe, Because I don't think angels live on a certain planet. I think they're in another dimension. So we're just aware of this one dimension of physical universe. We have no clue what it might mean beyond that. So to me, I don't think we're just sitting around. And I think worship is fantastic, and that will always be an integral part of it. But I don't think we'll just be singing songs in eternity or sitting on a cloud playing a harp for eternity. I think we'll be involved in meaningful relationships and, of course, relationship with God, because He can have a personal, close relationship with everybody simultaneously. Like we're in His throne room ourselves personally, individually, but He could do that with billions of people at the same time. So our relationship with God, our relationship with other people, and some kind of achievement and accomplishment, because we are at our best when we're achieving something significant. And I think that will only be enhanced in eternity.
Talk about eternity and all the good things that God has prepared for us. What does a person need to do to make sure they're ready for that, to be a resident of that city that we're talking about, that place?
Well, I'll answer that very simply. From start to finish, salvation is by grace through faith. So it's the gift of God to receive by our trusting in God. What does that mean practically? It means the first thing we do is we repent of our sins. We have to recognize we're sinners. We can't go to heaven in our sins. So we have to repent of our sins. Second thing, the New Testament tells us to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, the washing away of sins, removal of the penalty, the record, so that in judgment there is nothing to judge. And then, of course, and I'm quoting Acts 2:38, they receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit actually dwelling in us to enable us to live for Him. And I think that is the message of salvation in the New Testament. And we are part of that New Testament age. That's the message for the church today. And actually, Dr. Norris has recently written a book called Acts 2:38. So I'll let you say what you wish like about that.
Well, I since we're here at the end of the interview, so rather than hawk my book, which I could, I will also hawk this book,
yes.
Life, Death, and the End of the World. Buy now, buy often, buy many. Acts 2:38 is stories, and it really is a book you could give to anyone that in a non-confrontive way that tells the stories of why we do what we do and what the Bible teaches. And so I would also recommend that book as well, Acts 2:38, available at Pentecostal Publishing House. I want to pray a blessing on you today. Those of you who are watching this, I feel like God has something special for you. I don't think it's an accident that you're watching this. The Bible tells us to those who, King James doesn't say this language, but New King James says, eagerly wait for the coming of the Lord. He'll appear. He wants us to be on our tiptoes, expecting good things. He doesn't want us to have a spirit of fear. If you're watching the news before you go to bed, don't pray. If you're wringing your hands and watching some person all day long, maybe everything they're saying is true, but that's not really where you need to be focusing your attention, because God's bigger than any crisis that we have in the world. He has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. And I want to pray that blessing on you as we close. Lord God, I call down your blessing right now for this one who's watching today in the name of Jesus Christ. You have a special plan for them. You want to involve them in the greatest drama of all times. And you're going to use them, I pray, in the name of Jesus, to share good news to those that they know, and to have peace. I pray for peace. I call down peace in their heart in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you'd be with them, that you'd guide them. And I pray, Lord God, that you would do your will in them, which is to change the world in them and through them. We call these things down in the very special, precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Norris. I want to say thank you to both of you for participating in this conversation. I think people watch this, they have learned a lot. So pray that this has been a blessing. Thank you for tuning in today, and we pray God's blessings on you.
Being willing to have your eyes to be here this evening and to listen to that. I pray that you found that was very educational and understanding. If you want to watch that again, text me. Don't tell me or ask me, but text me, because if you tell me, I'll forget. But if you text me, I'll forward you this video, the link to this video. Now, if you're interested in the book that Brother Norris wrote called Acts 2:38, text me and I'll get you one. If you say, hey, Pastor, I'd like that book, guess what? Poof, I'll forget it. But if you text me, then I might remember, okay? So, real quick, before we go, any real quick questions? The exciting thing to me was, it's something I've been saying for a while, that it was just nice to hear somebody else that is of that level of education say it, is when we are called up in the rapture, that's our judgment. It's our reward. We've passed. We will not be a part of the final judgment where all of our sins are exposed, because all of our sins are covered in the blood of Jesus Christ. That's exciting. And there's just so much that we don't comprehend of what's going to happen in eternity that you know, we will never know here on earth. No man, no lady, no person knows the day or the hour that he is coming back. Nobody knows that. But not even the angels, according to Jesus, know that. But he'll be like a thief in the night, and he'll be here. So let's be ready when he comes. Can I get an amen? Amen. Greet one another with a smile on your face. Encourage one another. You're dismissed in the lovely name of Jesus. Thank you.
What I thought was I see.